Hazrat Maulana Ashraf Ali Thanvi Rahmatullahi Ali was also down that line. His work goes to over 800 to 900 books. You know, in some countries we see that Sufi word has become like a swear. Because tasawwuf is that branch of our deen which is the core of the deen. Hazrat mentions others like Firasatul Mu'min, Ilham, Ilmul Ladunni, Karamat, Fanafi Shaykh, Tasarrufu Shaykh. Respected elders, brothers, friends, we have very short time and plenty of things to cover. So, first of all, I would like to thank Brother Yahya of Al-Turaq publication for inviting me to this auspicious gathering. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reward him for the efforts he has gone through in inviting Hazrat Mufti Taqi Usmani Sahib, who is very extremely busy person, who took some of his time out and who has come here for the special reason of launch of this book. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give him good reward, and may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give long life to our Hazrat Mufti Taqi Usmani Sahib as well, so that we can benefit from him more often, inshallah. Brothers, first of all, with regards to a Turaq publication, before I forget, I want to mention something for those young boys or maybe ladies listening out there who are going for further studies. If you need some help, then Yahya Bhai has also started some scholarship, and you can take help from there with regards to your fees and these matters. Alhamdulillah, he is starting this good project. We also ask the congregation to support in this line as well. If someone is loaded over here, then help him. Inshallah, you will get help from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and reward as well from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And you will help the Muslim students to go further, study, become doctors, lawyers, barristers, engineers. You will get reward for that, inshallah. If possible, Yahya Bhai has kept some donation forms, £10 a month, installments. Use that and give your support. May Allah give you the tawfiq to do so. Respected elders, brothers, this program is about Hazrat Maulana Ashraf Ali Thanvi Rahmatullahi Alayh and this book of his which is called A Sufi Study of Hadith. Hazrat Maulana Ashraf Ali Thanvi Rahmatullahi Alayh was born in the year 1880 and passed away in the year 1943. This, I mentioned this so you can have a brief guideline with regards to the era of Hazrat Maulana Ashraf Ali Thanvi Rahmatullahi Alayh. According to the Hijrah calendar, from 1263 to 1362. We all know Hazrat Maulana Ashraf Ali Thanvi Rahmatullahi Alayh. I don't know about England, but in our country, India, Pakistan, Bangladesh, we knew Hazrat Thanvi Rahmatullah Alayh through his one book, which was a masterpiece. And it was a manual of fiqh for every household, which is known as Behishti Zewar. Heavenly ornaments, jewels of Jannah. This book was so nice and simple with regards to all Shariat and Tariqah, fiqh and tasawuf, everything in there. From ibadat, muamalat, akhlaq, muasharat, tasawuf, everything's in there. When this book was written, it was widely accepted, published, and throughout the whole Indian subcontinent it was spread. One of our elders once said that, you know, there was a time when for our small maslas we knew nothing and we had to go to the Imam Sahib or Maulana Sahib and ask that masla. But after this Behishti Zewar coming in our homes, our ladies tell us the masail. Because he was written for the ladies especially. The jewels are for the ladies. So Hazrat wrote it with the ladies in mind and wrote it from that angle. So teach them the masail. And Alhamdulillah, it was taught in our madaris And still in many madaris is being taught. Slowly, slowly other books have come like Tashil and this and that. But they don't have that profound knowledge which Behishti Zewar has. And I would say that in every maktab this book should be taught. Hazrat Maulana Ashraf Ali Thanvi Rahmatullahi Ali, he was a great scholar, great author. We knew him for his books, for his the way, manner in which he wrote the books. You know, we read over here that throughout the history, we see Jalaluddin Suyuti Rahmatullahi Ali was a prolific writer. And his work goes over like 500 books. And Sheikh Yusuf Talal over here writes that Hazrat Maulana Ashraf Ali Thanvi Rahmatullahi Ali was also down that line. His work goes to over 800 to 900 books. Large and small, some are small risalas, others are large. His Imdadul Fatawa goes into many volumes. His Bayanul Quran goes into three large volumes, Tafsir of Quran, with the translation in the common language, the getting away from the old tricky language. He wrote it in a very nice, simple manner, which every Urdu-speaking person can understand, which we need today for the English language as well. So Hazrat Rahmatullah Ali, not only an author, he was also from the other side, he was a reformer, he was a shaykh, he had many disciples. People used to come to his zaviya, his khanqah, and they would stay there for many, maybe weeks and months. And they would spend some chillas and times, months in his khanqah. Hazrat would take care of their food and their living, lodging, and they would reform themselves. And many disciples of his benefited from him. We know his disciples in the form of maybe Hazrat Mufti Shafi Sahab Rahmatullahi Ali, the father of our respected Hazrat Mufti Taqi Usmani Sahab, Hazrat Qari Tayyib Sahab Rahmatullahi Ali, the Muhtamim of Darul Ulum Deoband for 50 years, Hazrat Maulana Shabir Ahmad Usmani Rahmatullahi Ali, and others, many we go, Hazrat Maulana recently, Hazrat Maulana in Hardoi, Abrarul Haq Sahab Rahmatullahi Ali, also Dr. Abdul Hay Arifi, all these great mashayikh, they stayed in his company, benefited from him, Maulana Abdul Majid Dariabadi Rahmatullahi Ali. Maulana Abdul Majid Dariabadi Rahmatullahi Ali, he was a university student. And there was a time when he went out of the fold of Islam. He didn't believe. He became a heretic, mulhid. And he stayed in that condition for a good few years. But because of the du'as of his father, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala brought him back. And he read the kalima again. And then he came to the company of Hazrat Thanvi rahmatullahi alayhi. And he stayed in his company. And after his rectification, Hazrat Thanvi instructed him that you have good knowledge and good command on English language and good knowledge of the previous books, Tawrat, Zabur. So write a tafsir in which you mention those ayat of Tawrat and Injil as well, in cooperating with the Quranic ayat. And he wrote that real nice tafsir, which is Tafsir Majidi. And my brother Abdul Hafiz tells me that is the best translation of Quran by Hazrat Maulana Abdul Majid Dariabadi Rahmatullahi Alayhi, with this short sort of footnotes, and is very nice. If you can find it, read it, it's very beneficial. So Hazrat Rahmatullahi Alayhi's work goes in this field as well, reformation in the form of many disciples. Hazrat Maulana Ashraf Ali Thanvi Rahmatullahi Alayhi wrote this book, Sufi Study of Hadith. As Mufti Abdul Rahman mentions, the original name is At-Takashuf An Muhimmat At-Tasawwuf, meaning reality of the important aspects of tasawwuf. What is the reality behind the aspects of tasawwuf? Now, if we see over here, Hazrat is the first person to direct his attention towards this subject. If we go back into history, there were Sufi scholars who had written with regards to hadith and tasawwuf, combining them both together, like Harith ibn Asad al-Muhasibi, Abu al-Qasim al-Qushayri, Junaid Baghdadi, Sahl ibn Abdullah Tusturi. But their work was not focused entirely on hadith. And plus, Harith ibn Asad al-Muhasibi, a great Sufi scholar of the time of Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal rahmatullahi alayhi. But the Sufis of that time were regarded as dhaif and weak in relation to narrating ahadith. The reason Sheikh Yusuf Talal has given some other reason here, but in the Sharh of Muslim, Imam Nawawi rahmatullahi alayhi writes in one place that the reason why the Sufis are dhaif and weak in narrating ahadith is because there is a concept in Arabic called al-mar'u yaqisu ala nafsihi. A person judges the other one by himself. He thinks the other person is like me. So the Sufi never lies. So he thinks nobody lies. So that's why if anybody narrates a hadith, he takes it on its face value and he doesn't check what type of narrator it is. For that, you'll have to bring in Imam Bukhari and Imam Muslim and Abu Zura and Abu Hatim Razi and all those who will scrutinize each and every narrator and then check what level that hadith goes to. So this is the reason why their dhaf and weakness came, because the Sufis were Sufis, they were humble, they used to think that everybody is, speaks truth all the time, and that is why this came into their ahadith. So they wrote these book and incorporated. However, Hazrat Maulana Ashraf Ali Thanvi rahmatullahi alayhi took that onto a different level. He quoted in this book only ahadith from the 6 authentic books of ahadith: Bukhari, Muslim, Tirmizi, Abu Dawud, Nasai, Ibn Majah. Only those ahadith which are authentic, which have a proper chain of narration, which has been checked out by the muhaddithin. And he combined tasawwuf and hadith together in this book of his. Now, it's a really nice book. It's got very nice mazameen and contents in there. It was in Urdu language. And Hazrat Sheikh Yusuf Talal De Lorenzo, the translator, lives in Virginia, USA. He rendered it into English, and his English is very beautiful. He's kept that fluency of the writing of Hazrat Maulana Ashraf Ali Thanvi rahmatullahi alayhi. He's not let go of any of that. He's kept that fluency as it is, and the writing flows very smoothly. He writes in the preface that I did this translation in 1975 under the instruction of Hazrat Maulana Yusuf Binuri rahmatullahi alayh. Hazrat Maulana Yusuf Binuri, because he studied in Binuri town under Hazrat Maulana Yusuf Binuri rahmatullahi alayh. So he said, I wrote it then, and then it remained with me in the form of a manuscript and lying around somewhere. And he says that may Allah reward Brother Yahya Bata, that who urged me, and somehow he told me to go over it again, make some changes, amendments, and then he wants to publish it. So alhamdulillah, it's come in front of you, and it's here in the form of this book. So I will encourage you to buy it. It's a real nice book. I will give you a brief outline of the contents with regards to what's inside. First of all, the book is about tasawwuf. Tasawwuf. Now, what is tasawwuf? Tasawwuf is not something which is contrary to the Sharia. It's not something against Sharia. Some people make it like tasawwuf is some demonize it. People are scared. You know, in some countries we see that Sufi word has become like a swear. If you want to swear at someone, you call him a Sufi. See, it's a ghali ban gaya hai, ghali. It's a swearing word. So that's not right. Those who have condemned tasawwuf and demonized tasawwuf, I would say they are committing a criminal activity. And they will be judged by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the court of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on the day of Qiyamah. Because tasawwuf is that branch of our deen which is the core of the deen, which is the main aspect of the deen. Let me explain this. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sends Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam as a messenger. And he tells him there are 4 duties of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. هو الذي بعث في الأميين رسولا منهم يتلو عليهم آياته ويزكيهم ويعلمهم الكتاب والحكمة وإن كانوا من قبل لفي ضلال مبين. Reciting the verses of Allah, teaching them the meaning of those verses, teaching them the wisdom, and ويزكيهم, تزكية, purification, purifying their souls, rectifying their condition. So this tazkiyah, ihsan, suluk, this is the name, a reality of tasawwuf. Tasawwuf is just a name. In reality, it's mentioned in Quran and Hadith in the form of tazkiyah, in the form of ihsan. And in many places, Allah says, after taking 7 qasams, 7 oaths, والشمس وضحاها والقمر إذا تلاها والنهار إذا جلاها والليل إذا يغشاها والسماء وما بناها والأرض وما طحاها ونفس وما سواها فألهمها فجورها وتقواها. Allah says, قد أفلح من زكاها وقد خاب من دساها. The one who purifies his soul has succeeded. And the one who mixes it with the dust has failed. Many, many Qurani ayat ahadith. I don't want to go in there. I've got the yellow card. I don't want to wait for the red card. I will just read from over here. In the beginning, in the Muqaddama, Sheikh Yusuf Talal writes, I'll read his own words. He says, certain of the precepts of Sharia have to do with the believer's outer state, like prayer, fasting, hajj, zakah, marriage, divorce, discharging marital responsibilities, oaths and their expiation, buying and selling, legal procedures and giving witness, bequest, inheritance, meeting and socializing, greeting and entertaining, and so on. Knowledge of these matters is termed as fiqh. This is the Sharia. We have to follow these outwardly commands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then he goes on to say, certain others have to do with the inner state, such as one's love for the Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, awe of Him, remembrance of Him, acceptance of His decree, or one's decreasing love of the worldly, or lack of greed, or being constant, I don't know how to pronounce this, or sincere in religious matters, or one's lack of contempt for others, or lack of conceit, or having control over one's temper, and so on. These matters are termed as suluk, or inner conduct. Then, in the same way that a Muslim is to obey the rules of fiqh in his or her outward behavior, he or she must also obey the rules of the inner conduct. Moreover, it is usually as a result of some inner imbalance that irregularities occur in one's behavior or practice of Islam. For example, a decrease in love for the Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala may result in a lack of attention to daily prayers, salah. Or maybe one saying them hurriedly in a rushing manner. Similarly, as a result of stinginess, one might not give zakah, or he might not go on hajj. Or owing to one's inability to check one's anger, he may commit injustice or another, or injustice on another, or usurp the rights of the other person. Even if someone was to recognize one's faults and then take care to correct them, the fact remains that unless some sort of inner rectification takes place, one will be sure to lapse in one's efforts to correct the problem. And then Hazrat Sheikh Yusuf goes on to explain. Hazrat Thanvi Rahmatullahi Alayhi has written this book with regards to tasawwuf. He himself mentions the essence of inner conduct. He mentions 7 points over here. He says that if you are to become, go on the path of tasawwuf and suluk, don't think that you are becoming so that you can get some kushuf or karamat, or become a sheikh or a murid or a khalifa. No. Taking the path of tasawuf is just to become a good practicing Muslim. Then you will become a good practicing Muslim if you go along this path. That is why Hazrat Thanvi Rahmatullahi Alayhi narrates the essence of the inner conduct. Number one, neither kashf, vision, nor karama, minor miracles are required or expected. Two, on the day of judgment, no one other than yourself will be responsible for your salvation. 3. There is no promise that your worldly affairs will improve, or through your tying talisman or charms around your necks, or that you will win court cases or have an increase in income, or be cured of disease, or be granted knowledge of what is in the future by going on this path of tasawwuf. 4. He would say, your behavior will not be reformed merely through the attention and tawajjuh of your sheikh, nor will you cease to think evil thoughts. You will not automatically engage in ibadat without even having to resolve to do so. And your knowledge and understanding of the Quran and Islam will not necessarily register any sort of increase. 5. There is no promise that you will attain any spiritual state, or even that you will find pleasure in the performance of worship or spiritual exercise, or that you will not be beset by alien thoughts while in worship. There is no guarantee that you will wash your sins away with your tears of remorse. 6. In your performance of spiritual exercises, you need never see mystic lights or hear voices from the unseen. 7. You may never have a sublime or meaningful dream or receive guidance from the above. So this is how he explains haqiqat of tasawwuf. Hazrat Thanvi rahmatullah alayhi's preface, Hazrat has mentioned, you know, divided the contents of this book into 13 headings. With one hadith, he explains that hadith, he gives a heading for it, and then he gives two headings. He has divided them into 13 categories. For example, ashghal, ahwal, alamat, signs, character, states, practices, signs, teachings, virtues, habits, customs, questions, sayings, interpretations, corrections, miscellaneous. And all the ahadith, he has mentioned nearly 300 ahadith over here, just over 330 maybe. And every hadith has a heading, and he gives the translation and then explains what is behind that hadith. And the aspects of tasawwuf mentioned over here, Maulana Sahab, you'll have to give me 2 more minutes. Sorry. Like, for example, Hazrat explains the masail of tasawwuf. For example, he explains a subha. Sufi has a tasbih in his hand. This is no bidah. This is no shirk. He explains that with the hadith of Safiya radiallahu anha. When she was sitting, she had 4,000 date seeds in front of her, counting on them. So Hazrat Thanvi says, after mentioning that hadith, that you have 4,000 seeds separately, or you join them in one string and count on them, there is no difference, it's allowed. Counter, or you have a counter, tasbih on your hand, you count on that, it's only a muzakir. Suyuti rahmatullahi also narrated, written a risala on a subha, names it al-muzakira. Hazrat mentions others, like firasatul mu'min, ilham, ilmul ladunni, karamat, fanafi shaykh, tasarrufu shaykh. Sometimes the shaykh has tasarruf on the other person. A hadith from Ubay ibn Ka'b radiallahu anhu with regards to sabatu ahruf. He had some objection in his mind, and he says, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam placed his hand on my chest, and suddenly everything was gone, and as though Allah's arsh was before me, and I all the ishkal objections were gone. Hazrat proves that from there, the tasarruf of shaykh. Shaykh puts your hand or his hand on your chest, and maybe he can change the condition, like Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam did to Ubay ibn Ka'b, like Uthman ibn Abi al-As al-Saqafi. He said, Ya Rasulullah, I got many waswasas in my salah. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam told him to go become imam in Taif. And he says, I can't lead namaz because I get too many waswasas. So he said, come closer. And Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam put his hand on his chest, he turned around, put his hand on the back, and then Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam prayed something above him, and then he said, go. And he says, from that day onwards, I got no waswasas in salah, alhamdulillah. So from there, Hazrat explains this. Hazrat explains kashful Qubur. Sometimes the condition of qabr is open in front of someone. Hazrat explains the hadith that one sahabi was passing by. He put his tent on one place, he placed somewhere, and he says that he heard there was a qabr. He didn't know there was a qabr, and he heard someone reading Surah Tabarakalladhi biyadihi al-mulku wa huwa ala kulli shay'in qadir. So he came and he narrated that to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Hiya al-mani'a, hiya al-munjiya, tunji min adhabillah." So Hazrat Thanvi proves from there that sometimes the condition of qabr is open before some friends of Allah, like before this sahabi who is a wali of Allah, who is not a nabi, he is a wali of Allah. Allah opened that. So through this, he explains that in this book. Many other masail, Hazrat explains. Like, for example, Hazrat explains avoiding debate. The Sufis are taught not to debate with people. Be humble. He explains that hadith, مَنْ تَرَكَ الْمِرَاءَ وَهُوَ بَاطِلٌ فَبُنِيَ لَهُ بَيْتٌ فِي رَبَضِ الْجَنَّةِ وَمَنْ تَرَكَ الْمِرَاءَ فَهُوَ مُحِقٌ بُنِيَ لَهُ بَيْتٌ فِي وَسَطِ الْجَنَّةِ وَمَنْ حَسَّنَ خُلُقَهُ بُنِيَ لَهُ فِي أَعْلَاهَا. He says that Sufis should not argue with others. Be humble, be nice. These akhlaq, characteristics. Hazrat explains over here, original composition, awrad, azkar. He says that in one hadith of Ibn Umar in Sahih al-Bukhari, that in labbaik Allahumma labbaik, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would stop at labbaik la sharika lak inna alhamda wa ni'mata laka wal mulk. But Ibn Umar would increase in there, labbaik wal khayru kulluhu fi yadayk wal raghba'u ilayka wal amal. And he says, wal nasu yazeeduna thal mu'adij wa nahbahu, wal nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam yasma'u wa la yaqulu shay'an. That people used to add these words, Rasulullah used to hear, but he wouldn't say anything. Hazrat proves that as long as some azkar are not contrary to the maqsid of sharia, this allowed. So if some sort of azkar, awrad, and you do, so you don't need a hadith or a Quran ayat for every type of zikr you do. So for azkar, awrad, the sahaba were doing different words, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, it's okay, there's no harm in there. They added those words. So some people go around saying, no, everything in sunnah, so strict in there. No, no, bhai, be careful. That is the Dalil in there. Hazrat mentions these masail in many other masail, and Hazrat also goes on, you know, veneration of images. Some people keep, you know, mentioning this, Hazrat's main work, he was a reformist. Tasawwuf in Indian subcontinent had become so, you know, so low that people could not differentiate between a yogi and a Sufi. Because people thought that, oh, Sufi is like this, and people, and then they would get mixed up. So Hazrat Thanvi rahmatullah alayhi corrected, rectified everything and gave people the correct understanding of tasawwuf. So Hazrat rahmatullah alayhi, you know, got rid of the bad things as well. Like for example, keeping pictures in the home. Hazrat said, this is not allowed. He mentioned in this book the hadith, when Fathi Makkah, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam came, he went inside Kaaba and he saw the picture of Ibrahim and Ismail, and he said, Qatallahumullah, amma innahuma lam yastaqsima bil aslami qattu. And he said, wash those pictures away. So that means that you can't keep pictures of your Sufi or Buzrug or anyone in your home, hang them on the wall, keep them on your mobile and on your pictures or in photos in that manner. Hazrat said, this is not allowed, this got nothing to do with tasawwuf, this is haram. So these types of things, sometimes people think that, you know, a Sufi goes on to such an extent that he's omnipotent, omnipresent, and he's present everywhere, and he can do anything. Hazrat mentioned in this, still not allowed. Hazrat mentioned the hadith of Abu Talib, that Rasulullah was sitting there and Abu Talib died without kalima. So he said, if someone had that ability to change everything and do everything, then it would have been Abu Talib over there. So he, you know, keeps a balance between things in each everything. So this is the beauty of this book, and you can all buy it. It's not very expensive. It's for, spend a few pounds, buy it, read it. I've just given you a taste of what's in there. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give good reward to Hazrat Maulana Ashraf Ali Thanvi rahmatullahi alayhi. You know something? Never think bad about our Akabir Mashayikh. Let me just mention one incident. Someone came to Hazrat Thanvi rahmatullahi alayhi. He was from the Ahle Hadith sect. And he said, Hazrat, he was a nice person. He said, Hazrat, I want to become your murid. I want to be bayat with you. He became bayat. And he said, Hazrat, one problem. I am Ahle Hadith, and in my matters, I follow the Hadith. So what should I do? You are Hanafi, I am Ahle Hadith. So either, you know, I can't become bayat with you, or I have to let go of the Ahle Hadith. He said, no, no, no. You can become bayat. You can stay from the Ahle Hadith as well. However, keep your intention correct with regards to following hadith. Don't follow the hadith which you like, which suits your desire, which suits your nafs. Only follow hadith because it's hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And then he said, Hazrat, give me some advice. Hazrat said, okay, and on top of that, you know, two things. Don't have any bad thoughts about our aslaf, and don't say any bad words about our aslaf. Two things. So that person said, Hazrat, aapne to hamare maslak ki jadhi kaat di. Hazrat, you have cut off the roots of our maslak. Because our maslak is based on thinking bad about Salaf-e-Salihin and speaking bad about Salaf-e-Salihin. So you have put such a condition that you have cut off the roots of our maslak. So this is what I would say. Don't say a single bad word about Hazrat Thanvi or about our mashayikh Hazrat Nanotvi or Hazrat Gangohi or Hazrat Shaykhul Hind. They were all akabir awliyaullah. If you say bad, you will be held to account. They will hold you on the day of Qiyamah, in the Maidan of Hashr, in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So keep your tongues under control. Don't say anything bad about Hazrat Maulana Ashraf Ali Thanvi rahmatullah. Read his book and you will realize what a great personality he was. He was a great wali of Allah, friend of Allah, and you know, a reformer. Many have given him the title of Mujaddid. So be careful with regards to whatever you think and you say about Hazrat Thanvi rahmatullah. Hazrat Mufti Taqi Sahib will come. He will tell you his biography of Hazrat Thanvi rahmatullah. Wa akhiru da'wana alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. Wa sallallahu وسلم على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. أرجو رضاك يا الله، أنت الرحيم يا الله.